Hi, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to this year's Summit, Homeschooling Summit 2020. Joining us again this year is Peter Gray. It's an amazing long form interview. One question I didn't get to ask in that is Peter's thoughts about how do you see education playing out and changing, hopefully for the better, in the next 10 years, Peter?
Yeah, I can't say for sure that this is going to occur in the next 10 years, but could occur in the next 10 years, or at least the beginnings of it will occur in the next 10 years, I believe. So I wrote a blog post on this on my blog, Psychology Today blog, maybe it was about a year ago, called something like The Future of Education. And what I proposed, what my vision for the future of education is something like this. That the typical young person would go through two or three stages of education. The first stage is a stage that I called the stage of discovery. This is the stage of playing, exploring, socializing, learning in the ways that natural selection endowed children to learn about the world around them, learning about yourself, who you are, what your passions are, what you like to do. You know, this would be facilitated by settings like such as the Sudbury Valley School, where I have done research that where there's a lot of kids of all ages to play with, or several staff members who can be helpful and so on, where it's a community where you make rules. It could be done in homeschooling through what's called unschooling if it's a family that's able to connect you to the larger culture and provide the kinds of things that provide access to the kinds of things that children need in order to educate themselves, access to the tools of the culture, access to lots of other people so you hear different kinds of ideas, access to a whole range of children of different ages. These are things that children need. Maybe it will occur at libraries. I've been doing research aimed at learning how libraries are becoming more and more general resources for self-directed education, not just places to find books. A lot of libraries now have maker spaces in them in the United States. A lot of libraries are offering opportunities for free play. Many libraries, maybe most from the survey I've done recently, have places where teenagers can hang out and play games and chat with one another and socialize. I would envision maybe libraries could become, in some sense, they're publicly supported. They could become the publicly supported institutions of education for self-directed education. So that's where that would occur. So the first, you know, up to age somewhere between 15 and 18 typically, but for some kids maybe earlier, some kids later, that would be where that would be kind of your vehicle of education. And then the second stage, I've called the stage of career exploration. So, you know, sometime between the age of 14 and 20, you've developed a sense of what it is that you might want to do as a career. You're recognizing your parents aren't going to be supporting you all your life. And maybe you even want to get out of their house. Right? So I'm going to have to figure out a way to make money. I'm going to have to figure out a way to make a living here. Now, ideally, you've already had, this is another thing we've been depriving our children of, you've already had opportunity for at least some part-time jobs, you know, the kind of things kids used to do. I had jobs beginning at 11, you know, as a kid. It was pretty common for kids to have jobs, and that gave them a little of their own money and freedom. So, but now would be the stage really of career exploration so let's imagine that in your play and exploration and learning about the world in you think you want to become, let's say, a doctor, just to take something that sounds kind of prestigious. A lot of people might think they want to become a doctor. So I've decided I want to become a doctor. Well, in the current situation, if you decide you want to become a doctor, the next step is you would go to a four-year liberal arts college in the United States, in which you would learn nothing about doctoring. You wouldn't have any more idea what it is to be a doctor after 4 years and a couple hundred thousand dollars of tuition payments. You wouldn't have any more idea what it is to be a doctor. And then you apply to medical school. You've worked your butt off to get high grades and do all this stuff to get into medical school. You get into medical school and now it's a lot more money and you take out loans. Now you're in medical school. At some point in medical school, you begin to interact with actual patients. Oh, and now is not the time you want to learn. I really don't like being around sick people, you know. So wouldn't it be better if instead of doing all that, you actually explored that career? And the best way to explore that career is through some kind of a low-level job or an apprenticeship or an internship that would bring you into touch with what you would actually be doing in that career. Maybe you'd be an orderly in a hospital. Maybe you'd be an assistant to a doctor or to a nurse. You'd have some kind of a job that actually puts you in touch with sick people, puts you in touch with doctors and nurses, and you can see what their life is like and can see what they do. So that would be the next stage. Maybe you're thinking you want to be a chef. Well, you hire yourself as a line, you get a job as a line cook, you know, working under a chef. Whatever it is, you want to be an electrician, you'd be an electrician's assistant for a while. You know, you're not responsible for the decision. Whatever it is you do, you try it out. And suppose you don't like it. Well, you haven't invested anything. In fact, you've made a little money doing it. Maybe even enough to get an apartment of your own, or at least to pay your parents a little bit of rent so that they aren't so resentful of you being there, right? So instead of tuition, instead of a cost, a burden to your parents, you become, you know, you feel good about that. So, but you haven't wasted a lot of time. You know, you might discover in a few months, oh, this actually isn't it to me. Let me try something else. And then suppose you finally discover what you do like to do. And in some cases, you just continue doing it. Maybe you go on from being an assistant in whatever the thing is to being a master, like the old time crafts. You would become an apprentice to somebody who could do it, and you would learn through being an apprentice. That can still work in some cases. But there are a lot of kinds of careers where we want to make sure that where there's good reason to certify people. There's good reason to say, this person has demonstrated that they know standard practices in this field. I don't want a surgeon to be learning by trial and error when he's doing surgery on me. I want that surgeon to have gone through some rigorous tests of his ability and knowledge about everything having to do with the operation he's done to me. I want to be sure that people who have done that a million times have looked over that guy's shoulder or that woman's shoulder and made sure that they know what they're doing before that person is turned loose on me. I want to make sure, and similarly with an electrician, if there's going to be an electrician who wires my house, I don't want my house to burn down at some point because this person didn't know what he was doing. So I think it's quite legitimate that people who are going into professions where somebody's life could depend upon their doing it right, that we want to certify them for doing it. And so therefore, I would retain professional training schools, would retain medical schools, would retain schools for training people to be electricians or plumbers and those kinds of things, whatever it is. And so the next stage, suppose you're in something like medicine, you want to pursue medicine. So the next stage, maybe you've been an assistant to a nurse for a period of time, and now you've really say, you know, I really like this job. I want to be a nurse or I want to be a doctor. And if you're applying to nursing school, I think there should be nursing schools. If you're applying to medical schools, there should be medical schools. So let's say you decide you want to be a doctor. You apply to a medical school, and what's the basis for your application? Your application is based on there are these doctors who've seen you around them, and they're vouching the fact this person really is good around people who are sick. This person has the right kind of disposition for it. This person seems to be intelligent. I've seen him take initiative or her take initiative. This person seems to me to have the qualities to become a doctor. Well, then the medical school might say, well, that's all fine and good, but there are a few things we want to also make sure that this person can do before we invest our time in this person as a medical student. So we want to be sure that this person can handle the intellectual intellectual aspect, the academic rigor of our medical training. And so we're going to require you to take a course in organic chemistry. Who knows exactly why it is, but somehow organic chemistry is the key to medical school, right? But let's say there's some legitimacy to that, right? So so we're going to require you to take a course and prove to us you can do well in a course in organic chemistry. So this isn't like you don't have to go do a whole liberal arts college, which has nothing to do. You just have to do what we're saying is important to us to come into the medical school. I think that with this plan, what I'm describing, the four-year colleges would die, but community colleges might not. Community colleges would now begin to offer organic chemistry to people who want to go to medical school. They would offer a little opportunities to learn about circuits and electricity to people who want to become electricians. They would offer that. They're already pretty good at this kind of thing, meeting the needs of the people in the community. So those would persist, but it's not like you got to do the whole darn thing, you know. You just take the courses that are relevant and important to what you want to do for your career development. If you wanted to be, in my plan, you know, universities as primarily places that are supported by students' tuition and primarily thought of as for higher, so-called higher education, liberal arts education would die out, but universities themselves would die out. They would be reduced in number. Universities serve a very important function in our society. They are the places of scholarship and science supported by government. So they would remain as places of scholarship and science. They would remain as places where we have historians who have the luxury of devoting their time to doing historical research and writing historical works that cannot be supported through private enterprise. They would have there would be a place of science where people can do science that's government supported rather than business supported. So you don't have the business pressures to get the results that the business wants you to get. But presumably the public has a vested interest in your finding the truth. So science should be publicly supported rather than supported by private industry. And universities would be the place that would happen. Now, suppose you decided in your exploration and play that you wanted to be a scientist or that you wanted to be a historian. Then you would go to the university, but not as a student. You would go there in the same way that you would as an apprentice if you were going on someplace else. You would go to work in the laboratory of a scientist in the realm that you're interested in. You would become sort of like a graduate students are today. You're not spending your time. You're spending your time at practical endeavors, and you're learning science firsthand. And you're reading in relationship to that. And ultimately, you might advance to the point where you can get your own grants. And maybe there would be a degree certification, but it'd be a little bit more like going directly to become a graduate student rather than to become an undergraduate, which is pretty much like an extension of high school as it's carried out in the United States today. So that's my vision, probably a little longer than you anticipated, but that's my vision for the future of education.
Well, let's hope that comes to fruition, Peter, because that sounds like a great way for society to move forward after, going through this pandemic and getting a chance now to rebuild. Let's hope people take that chance.